Hi, I'm Dan Danford. We're doing a series of podcasts called Money Made Easy for Dad's Divorce. We usually just take a question that's been posed by one of our viewers on the website and I answer it as best I can. This week's is one that I deal with every day in my profession. It's about mutual funds. I understand the concept of mutual funds and what they are, but what are the advantages and disadvantages of mutual funds? Okay, you really asked me a loaded question. I could spend hours talking on this subject, but I'm gonna make it very concise. We're gonna not bore you to details with all kinds of details and things about mutual funds. For those people who are watching that may not know very much about mutual funds are basically a pooled investment concept. What you do is you add your $100 with 1,000 other people who all put up $100, and then that pool of money is invested in a particular type of investments. And all of you enjoy some benefits from doing that, and there are some disadvantages as well. So let's touch on that a little bit. I guess what I'd say right off the bat is some mutual funds are very expensive. Some of them are very confusing. A typical problem we have with mutual funds is there are a lot of different funds that call themselves growth funds. Okay, but a growth mutual fund can mean a whole bunch of different things. So just them calling themselves a growth fund isn't very helpful. You can also encounter managers that are inept. They don't do a very good job of managing mutual funds. And I guess what I'd say is today we have created this environment where there are probably too many choices for most people. Now, on the plus side, the good reason why mutual funds are so good, well, there are a couple different things, but one that I think of all the time is diversification. If you have $100 to invest, it's really hard for you to go to a broker or somebody and buy a diversified portfolio with just $100, okay? Because there aren't any investments that sell for $10 a piece, or you might buy one share of different investments, which isn't practical at all. But as part of this portfolio that may own hundreds or thousands of things, you own a prorated share of each one of those things. So your $100 really can be spread out among many, many, many different things in a mutual fund where you couldn't accomplish that on your own. It'd be very hard, probably, to build a portfolio that's adequately diversified with even $10,000. Some of the studies say you need to have somewhere over 15 different investments in a portfolio to achieve good, solid diversification. Well, with a $10,000 portfolio, it's pretty hard to accomplish 15 different holdings. And yet, that same $10,000 put in a mutual fund will be adequately diversified. So, I mean, you can accomplish that where you couldn't do it on your own. Another big thing that happens with mutual funds is that there's a professional investment manager involved. So the person who chooses the investments in that portfolio has a level of expertise that you and I probably couldn't achieve on our own. Say that mutual fund is offered through Vanguard or Fidelity or American Century, okay? They have whole teams of researchers and managers who do nothing but try to find the best investments in certain sectors, okay? And those people manage those funds. And the last thing I'd say is that they might be buying tens of thousands of shares of a particular stock. They aren't going to pay the same retail price per share, per trade, that you and I do. So there are some efficiencies they can realize based on volume that we can't accomplish on our own. So those three things alone, broad diversification, professional management, and efficiencies are the primary advantages of mutual funds over trying to do it on your own. I have some basic rules that I use for mutual funds. First of all, no individual investment, whether it's a mutual fund or a stock or a bond or whatever, is good or bad on its own. It's good or bad for your situation. So the first rule is you need to decide what your objectives are for a particular pool of money and how you want to invest that. Okay, once you've done that, then you start screening the choices to choose funds that have You know, decent performance, low fees, they fit the sectors that you need to fulfill your portfolio, and then you make some choices. And just keep screening. We want funds that have performance that are 4 and 5 stars over the last 2 years. You keep just narrowing the list until you get a list of 4 or 5 funds that have been really, really good in that sector of the economy, what you're trying to accomplish there. Now, truthfully, any of those 4 or 5 funds would probably be a great choice for your portfolio. Okay? Just makes sense. These are the ones that, by all the criteria we use, have screened out. We also eliminate people funds that are managed, that the manager hasn't been there for 4 or 5 years. I mean, if the manager's fairly new, then all the past performance doesn't make that much difference. When we get down to that 5 or 6 funds at the end of the list, the last choice we make is we choose the one with the lowest fees. Okay? I'm going to share this little bit with you just because I think it's very helpful. 10-15 years ago, somebody did a study on mutual funds, and what they wanted to know was what are the key indicators of whether a mutual fund will be good or bad in the future. Basically came down to 2 things. Okay? The first thing was that funds that tend to do well are funds that have done well in the past. Okay, and another part of that same point is bad funds have done really bad in the past. And as you look at those 2 statements, the stronger of the 2 is the bad funds. You know, while it's a good thing to have a good fund, it's a terrible thing to have a bad fund. They just keep getting worse and worse and worse. So that's one thing. You look at past performance. Has this fund done well or bad against other similar managers? So that, and whatever you find out there, whether it's good or bad, that tends to continue in the future. The second criteria, and this one is one that I'm just killer on when it comes to building portfolios. Funds with higher fees do worse for their shareholders. Okay, so what you're really looking for, I mean, if you screen out all the other junk about mutual funds, what it really boils down to is funds that have performed well in the past and have low fee structures tend to do the best going forward. Okay, so in any category you're looking at, when you're building a portfolio, what we tend to do is we want to have some large company stocks, some mid-sized company stocks, some small company stocks, some international stocks, and the balance of the portfolio we want to have in high-quality, short to intermediate-term bonds. Okay, that's how we build the portfolio. What you want to do is you want to choose mutual funds in each one of those areas that have had good performance in the past and have low fees going forward. And if you do that, you'll have the highest probability of success as you go forward. Now, there are whole books, there are libraries on choosing mutual funds. Okay, I've built a business on choosing mutual funds for portfolios for my clients. I mean, a lot of details in this. I'm trying to share with you 5 or 6 minutes today that'll give you kind of an overview as you look forward. Go to the library, or better yet, go to your local university and buy a book on investments, the kind of things they teach in class. Take out the sales hype, okay? Don't go buy a mutual fund because you got on their website and they said it was a good mutual fund, okay? Everybody says their mutual funds are good. You know, go someplace where you can get good, reliable data on the mutual fund from a solid third-party choice, a source of research information, and then make your decisions based on that. Truthfully, mutual funds are the best choice for most people in their investing today. Okay, that's it for another episode of Money Made Easy. I'm Dan Danford, and we'll see you next week. Thanks.